This is Boomer Life on Sea Isle 650.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I need
Ah, that's what I want. Gotta love that money. Welcome back to Boomer Life. Sterling Fox with you, joined in studio by Brett Luckin. Mr. Luckin is a trustee in bankruptcy with Abacan and Associates here in Vancouver. They, by the way, are A-B-A-K-H-A-N is the way to spell Abacan. Now, George would appreciate it if I pointed that out. Would. He likes to do that a few times every program. We talked before the break, Brett, about the fact that there are two remedies available to Canadians who find themselves in enormous financial difficulties. How many folks, that would be the bankruptcy or the consumer proposal.
Correct.
When someone in deep financial trouble finally comes to pick up the phone and call you and arranges for a chat with you, you're feeling pretty at the end of the road by this time, and chances are you're feeling rather beset upon. How many people who call you in that kind of deep financial trouble even know about a consumer proposal? I'm assuming a lot of people call you up going, well, I've had it. I can't do the math anymore. I've got to go bankrupt. I guess I have no other choice.
Yes. Largely speaking, most people phone up and say, I think I have to go bankrupt.
Right.
What does it mean if I go bankrupt? Will I lose my house? Will I lose my car? What does it mean? It is improving in that there's a lot of people who do internet research and then call up and say, I need you to explain this thing they call a consumer proposal.
Right. We are fairly internet literate. Maybe not financially literate, but we can at least poke around on the internet.
But largely speaking, still, there is a myth out there that if I cannot repay my debt, bankruptcy is my only alternative.
Right.
Yeah.
And again, accompanying that myth, because you don't get into a situation like this until you really have been harassed and you really do feel that the sort of world, your world as you know it, is certainly coming to an end. And it seems everything is made to seem so dire that a bankruptcy it appears to be the only option available. So back to the big difference between a bankruptcy, which is the end of it,
right,
versus a consumer proposal, which is, hey, you know, if we can just get these creditors, that the people I owe money to who are all over me now, if we can get them to back off, recognize the fact that I would love to repay them, but I can't afford to do it under the present circumstances, maybe we can do some business
here. Yes. You know, a consumer proposal, as I noted earlier, effectively is you compromising. You're saying, I can repay you. This is what you're saying to your creditors. I can repay you, but I can't do it at 100 cents on the dollar anymore.
Right.
And often it can be as low as 20 cents or 30 cents on the dollar. And the day that you file a consumer proposal, it's interest-free. So in other words, particularly you go start with things like Canada Revenue Agency debt with penalties and interest, credit cards. It's obscene the kind of interest that will start adding up when you're not paying your debt.
Oh, absolutely. So if you file a consumer proposal, that freezes the interest.
Correct.
Okay.
The interest clock will stop on that day.
Okay. And what about all of those, I'm trying to think of a nice way of saying, all of the jerks who call you trying to collect money and being just really just the most negative human beings imaginable.
In fact, the day you file, the next time one of those credit collectors call you.
Oh, you found a nice word. Okay, good for you.
Credit collectors call you. You can simply just tell them that you filed a consumer proposal with Abacan and Associates.
Right.
Give them our telephone number, and I assure you, they just simply stop calling.
Okay. And that's the law, right?
Well, A, it's the law, but B, there's no financial incentive for them to call you anymore.
Right.
Because they're not going to get paid by you anymore. They are now going to get paid through the trustee in bankruptcy. So we become the communication point.
I see.
For the bank or the collectors or whatever it may
be. And in a lot of cases, Brett, it's that almost daily harassment, the nasty letters in the mail, the phone calls and all of that. It's that buildup of that pressure that really does make life incredibly uncomfortable.
Yes. Well, you know, I think, Sterling, the real issue is that because there's so much fear, I mean, there's generally people are afraid of the unknown.
Mm-hmm.
So what you tend to see, often we see people who put their heads in the sand for a long time, months or even years sometimes, and just avoid the whole issue completely. And then when they realize that they actually have to solve this, that bankruptcy may be the only option available to them, because that's what they think, it's only bankruptcy.
Well, that's right, yeah.
Now they have no idea how that works. So then they spend a lot of time on the internet. They figure out, oh, there is something else called a consumer proposal.
Right.
But now they have to cross this line where they actually have to phone a trustee in bankruptcy because they don't really know how it works. They have a vague idea based on what they've read.
Right.
But now they have to phone someone and they have to overcome that fear in order to do that. And I got to tell you that really what you should be doing is way earlier in the process. You should be calling someone like myself and trying to understand and let us explain it to you so you don't get caught up in things you don't know.
So if you start to feel your head slipping underwater when you're doing the calculations month to month, assuming that you're doing any kind of calculations,
yes.
then you can sense. It doesn't take a – you don't have to be a rocket scientist to realize the numbers don't add up.
Mm.
So in those early moments –
you should
moments,
be calling people like us.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Do people do that usually?
No. And that's the sad reality. They don't. They try and make it work themselves. They start robbing Peter to pay Paul. They will do things like pay the minimum payment on their credit card.
Right.
Sometimes for years.
Mm-hmm.
Without realizing that all they're really doing is staying at exactly the same place and not moving anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, if anything, all that's happening is that the interest is accruing over a period of time. And so they're going nowhere. So and you know, I have had people come into my office. When I sit down and they talk about their history and how they've got to that point, I realize if they had filed 4 or 5 years earlier, had come and seen me and filed a consumer proposal 4 or 5 years earlier, they would already be on the other side of their debt and moving forward in their life.
Okay.
But that what they've been doing in the interim is just servicing their debt by just paying the minimum interest payments or whatever the bank says their credit cards need, $10, $20,
sure, right, yeah.
$50 a month.
Mm-hmm, just to keep the account alive, yeah.
And never gone anywhere.
Right.
And now it's got to the point where they can't do that anymore.
Okay, let's take a look, if you don't mind. And I know this is pretty rudimentary stuff for you, but for those of us who are in some kind of financial discomfort, and boy, that's a pretty mild statement because it gets pretty beyond discomfort in a big, big hurry. Let's talk about what are the usual factors that contribute to a person ending up in your office at Abacan & Associates, Brett, looking for a remedy. Let's talk about why people go bust.
Right.
And give us some of the more typical. You've been at this for years,
yeah.
So what? Give us some ideas of what people the usual scenarios are.
The most obvious things are an unexpected disaster of some sort, some kind of catastrophe in their life. It could be an accident in a motor car. It could be a family member that was a breadwinner, unfortunately losing their life or something to that effect, or being hurt to a point where they no longer be able to be the sort of main breadwinner.
Mm-hmm.
So unexpected disasters are big things, and those are cataclysmic. Obviously, you were fine 1 month, and the following month you're not.
Right.
Marital separation and divorce, very often you find people don't really process it through in their mind that the moment they separate and they get divorced, suddenly they have two household costs to look after. There's two rents or two mortgages. You know, there's two utility bills, etc. And so all costs suddenly multiply.
Right.
Very often there's a family, one of the couple does not earn as much money as the other and now is not able to look after themselves, despite child or spousal support.
Have you ever had a situation where someone comes to you, a divorcing couple comes to you and says something to the effect of, or one of the two parties says, you know, he had to have this expensive supercar that I wanted no part of. He couldn't afford it in the first place, and he still insists on trying to pay for it. I want nothing to do with it. If I go bankrupt, am I discharged from any obligations to that stupid car he wanted in the first place?
Yeah.
And I'm being gentle again.
Yes, I know. You are being gentle. You know, what I will say to you, I can say this, is that I often speak to the woman in relationships,
right,
who refer to their husbands, some of their husband's toys in a way which basically indicates that they don't support him owning those things.
Exactly. Well, I was sort of headed down that street terms.
And you know what? Again, that's another myth that exists, is that simply because I'm in a relationship with somebody that I'm not suddenly on the hook for the car or the skidoo, you know, or
right.
the houseboat, whatever. That's not true.
So it isn't true. So you can't just divorce the guy and walk away from his ridiculous debts that he ran up, even though you disapproved in the first place.
Well, what'll happen is that unless you have co-signed on the debt, the debt's not yours.
Mm.
Okay. So unless you physically put a signature on a piece of paper somewhere, the debt is not yours. So you're not on the hook for the car. You're not on the hook for the houseboat or the skidoo or whatever it might be. But clearly, if you're in a position like that, and I've got to tell you, this is something I suspect trustees and bankruptcies deal with all the time, because I know I do. So I suspect there's many of us who have these kinds of problems. And that is that when you have couples coming to see you, often that financial stress or pressure they are under is leading to them splitting up, getting divorced.
Yes.
Okay. And
well, you know, you go back to square one. What do couples argue about the most?
Money.
My gosh, it's money. No,
it's time, isn't it? It's money. You know, other reasons why people declare personal bankruptcy are the obvious ones, such as income reduction or job loss.
Sure.
You know, unemployment's the most obvious thing.
Sure.
And once you got a job, you can pay that credit card, you can pay that line of credit, you can pay the mortgage, and now suddenly you're not able to do so.
Or maybe that unexpected situation that you talked about earlier, a medical thing. You get sick and suddenly you're
cancer.
Not, you can't go to work anymore. Yes, you can't keep the cash flow going.
I had a couple come see me the other day, and the wife has a very unusual illness, and the illness is debilitating, and she's going through multiple surgeries, etc., and she had to stop working as a result of being so ill.
Right.
And his income is not sufficient to support them as a family. So the result is that despite all the pressure and the stress associated with the illness, furthermore, they have to debate bankruptcy.
Right.
So that's a common one as well. But by far the most common, I believe, though, is financial mismanagement. And I don't say that in a negative way. I don't want to cast aspersions on people. I just want to say to you that the way people handle their money is by far the most common cause of having to go bankrupt.
We're
a
little cavalier about it. Oh, come on, it's only money. Oh, come on.
Very often, the other issues, such as the unexpected disaster, etc., some of those problems can be resolved if you immediately take action.
Mm-hmm.
You understand your income is instantaneously compromised in some way.
Sure.
And you react to that by clamping down on your expenditure,
right,
looking at where you're spending your money. But often people don't do that. Their income reduces, but there's a lag on them thinking about how they're going to also reduce their expenses on a monthly basis. You see that often in retirement, where people carry costs and expenses forward into their retirement and don't predict that as their income declines as they cross the age of 60 or 65.
That lifestyle prior to retirement, it could be a little bit more expensive.
The line of credit is not sustainable.
Right.
The amount of money you pay for your cars every month is not sustainable. The trips that you take, these things are not sustainable.
We need to take a break, but just on that theme, very quickly, if you are a retired person and you still have debt and obligations and all the rest of it, of course, I would assume, Brett, it's much more difficult to get new money, to get a loan, if you have no visible means of support. You're retired. Now, you might be on a pension, but, you know, are lenders going to be comfortable with taking pension income and for?
It's a practical problem. It is. When you hit the age of 60 or 65 and you're retiring and your income is reduced, it is far more difficult to get credit. And let's be honest, you don't want to buy yourself or tie yourself into another 10 or 15 or 30-year repayment plan at the age of 60 or 65.
Right.
This is the time you're supposed to be enjoying your life.
Right. And if you aren't, and if the shoals are a little rocky and you find yourself dangerously close to them, especially as you approach or enter retirement and things just aren't as they should be, if you haven't done so in the past, this might be a smart time to sit down with a pro, a trustee like yourself.
Yes, that's the right time to come and speak to people like us. It's unfortunate that many of those people are forced to go into bankruptcy simply because that, and here's the key with a consumer proposal. You are repaying your debt.
Right.
It translates into some kind of dollar value on a monthly basis over 5 years maximum.
Mm-hmm.
That is what, if you are able to make that dollar repayment over 5 years and commit to it, a consumer proposal will work for you. If you are not, then the unfortunate reality is then bankruptcy is your only option.
Our guest on this episode of Boomer Life is Brett Luckin. Brett is a trustee in bankruptcy with Abacan and Associates, with offices in downtown Vancouver at 625 Howe Street. And you can find them online at abacan.com. And that, by the way, is spelt A-B-A-K-H-A-N. CanadaOnly.com. And we're back with lots more. Stay with us here on CIAL 650.
Canada's only weekly radio show dedicated to the baby boomer lifestyle. This is Boomer Life on CIAL 650.